Hello everyone, as you may remember, the first part of lecture 12 was not recorded properly, so what I'm doing now, I'm re-recording it. So, before starting, let me share my screen with you guys, girls, and let me share my screen with you. Is that what I did? Now, I believe you may be able to see me. And I want to briefly recall that what happened last time. Last time we talked about basics of lame acceleration and basics. And so what I want you to remember from that point, I want you to remember that there are different mechanisms of acceleration. So there's actually three mechanisms of acceleration that you should remember. It's finger flame acceleration. Here you may remember this mechanism, how it goes. And basically the idea about that mechanism that here you may see this movie, you ignite a flame front, you have a chamber, you have a cylinder or channel which is filled with premixture, and this cylinder, as long as it's filled with premixture, you ignite it here at the center close to the wall, and then flame expands. And here you may see how it goes. You may see simulation and series, but the key point of this mechanism is the following, that originally flame accelerates hemispherically, right? Hemispherically, but as long as the flame surface start approaching approaching the wall, we have different velocities in radial and axial direction, so flame accelerates fast and accelerates exponentially with the following acceleration rate, which is quite, this mechanism is fast. And what is also important, it's scale invariant. So you will face the same feature in channels and you will face the same feature in coal mines, for instance. But this mechanism is slow and will stop as soon as the flame contacts the wall. There is another mechanism of flame acceleration that we discussed. And basically this is due to wall friction. And as you, idea is very simple. Let's assume you have a flame, you have a wall. Wall provides pre-friction, so when flame propagates, it generates a flow. But the flow is not uniform. You have maximal velocity at the axis and zero velocity at the wall. So flame is corrugated. And when flow gets corrugated by this motion, it will elongate the flame. So you have positive feedback between the flame and the flow. It's very simple model. It does not account for turbulence. It doesn't account for instabilities, but it's enough to describe unlimited flame acceleration. Very simple. Flame produces flow. Flow is not uniform. Flow has Poisson-like profile with maximum velocity at the axis and zero at the walls. So this flow corrugates the flame. Flame propagates. It propagates fast and so on and so on. And when flame propagates fast, it provides stronger flow. Stronger flow is more corrugated, it elongates the flame more and so on. So we discuss it, but we realize that this mechanism, we describe it theoretically, computationally, and we realize that this mechanism is unlimited, but it's quite slow. And the way to combine them was when we incorporate so-called obstacles, right? It allows you to combine two mechanisms, fast and slow. And remember, when we deal with obstacle flame acceleration, it's really something special. Here you may see how flame propagates through the set of obstacles and how detonation happens. It's really very fast mechanism. Let's see how it goes, how it accelerates and detonates. It's something really extremely strong, extremely specific. So please realize it. Right? So that's what I described at the last lecture. We described this mechanism. And basically, what we are going to do now in chapter 12, it's how to control it. So I told you that like my NSF career is named Promotion and Prevention of Flame Acceleration and EDT from Fundamental Studies to Practical Consideration. So what we discussed in lecture 11 was practical consideration, right? It was really practical consideration. It was really, sorry, Fundamental Studies. Now we talk about practical consideration, how we can employ it, how we can make it practical, how we can control it, how we can accelerate or slow down. So that's what we are going to talk, controlling strategies for promotion and prevention of flame acceleration and DVT. And we will consider separately two configurations with and without obstacles. This will be, first one will be part of this topic of this lecture, while right-hand side will be considered in part two, which I post separately. So basically, that's the idea. So if you have finger, depending on what you have initially, finger flame acceleration, or you start planar one, we have the following acceleration stage. Again, please go back to lecture 11 for details if you want, but here I recall the basic idea. Here are the following stage of flame acceleration. Flame accelerates exponentially. Then, when flame propagates faster and accelerates exponentially, eventually compressibility comes to play. So you have compression of the fuel of the burnt metal, so you decrease thermal expansion, so flame starts going slower. It goes slower, slower, so you moderate your acceleration, at least from exponential to linear stage. And then eventually you may have so-called saturation stage. This is so-called, this stage, I would say, correlate well with so-called Chapman-Jouguet deflagration. I recall you what it is. Well, Chapman-Jouguet deflagration is specific regime of burning. When flame propagates fast, it propagates supersonically with respect to observer in laboratory reference frame, but fuel is also pushed. So with respect to fuel, it still propagates subsonically. So this is not a detonation, it's a flame, it's deflagration. That is Chapman-Jouguet deflagration. And eventually we realize that later we have drastic jump and it happens due to viscous heating. And eventually we have this. We have this stage. We have this transition, we have this the jump, and eventually it evolves into detonation. Why does it happen? You may remember, and I have actually this lecture 11 slides, how it happens. So basically it happens at this stage because of hydraulic resistance. If you may see how it goes, I recall here it is. So flame propagates, and you may see, but explosion happens at the walls. And this is curious. So, and if you look at this colorful picture, you may see this detonation happen at the walls. Detonation is presented here in this temperature diagram by red color, while deflagration is presented by green color. And this is hydraulic resistance. So please remember, realize that all four processes participates here. You have flame acceleration, you have slowdown, you have saturation, and hydraulic resistance come to play here. And before this point, you may realize, as long as flame accelerates, role of hydraulic resistance is minor, because temperature at the walls and temperature at the central line are about to be the same. But here, when you attain the saturation stage, they keep will become different. At the central line, there is no acceleration anymore, so temperature keeps the same, but at the walls, it keeps growing, and eventually explosion happens. And that's curious because, remember, we have friction at the walls. So flow, there is no flow motion at the walls. Flow stays at the walls. If there was no friction, flame would propagate as a planar and there would be no acceleration at all. Flow stays at the walls. Acceleration happened at the center line. But due to this friction, eventually detonation happens exactly at the walls. Please remember this. So here are our stages. And basically, in our, what we are going to talk now, well, here it is. So we have these stages. And now, so how, if you what can we promote, or how we can reduce this scenario? Well, if you talk about fire safety, of course, you don't want to have acceleration at all. You want to slow down it. You want to avoid it. So as all the stage, you would like to reduce flame acceleration. If you're here, you would like to slow down it. If you're here, you would never have this transition. But what is more sophisticated, curious, how we can utilize detonation? Because you know, in rotation detonation engines, these pulse detonation engines, we want to use detonation because detonation is most effective. That's what you want to use. And here I can propose you an alternative. So why instead of detonation, you can use fast deflagration, fast flame? Well, it will be less effective, but it will be still much more effective than classical deflagration. It will be much more safe. Does it make sense for you? I hope so. That's why, what should I do if I want to make a new device based on this? I want this saturation stage keep as long as possible. And then I should be more sophisticated. So what should I do? When my flame accelerate here, I would try to accelerate it as fast as possible. I would like to put everything I can to accelerate the stage. So I want to accelerate it. I wanted to attain the saturation stage as fast as possible. By then, I want to keep the stage as long as possible, so it's never detonated. How to put it? Well, that's what we're going to discuss. Wall condition, temperature condition, mechanistic boundary condition, Lewis number, thermal expression. That's we are going to clarify how we can do it. Well, last time we presented the theory, how it goes. I may skip, and you know that we demonstrated exponential acceleration regime. Here I want to skip a couple of following slides. You really don't need it for this particular class, but I want you to show the following one, which demonstrates that exponential acceleration is not always. It was my student Bernie Mergok, who works in Pennsylvania for Volvo, and he demonstrated actually that if you reduce thermal expansion or increase the channel size, instead of exponential acceleration, you may have linear acceleration. Basically, this basically, please understand this diagram. This is not say theta versus rho. Rho is flame readiness number, theta is thermal expansion. It shows regime of acceleration. So for the, if you go here, 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 if you go in this domain, for given theta and radius, you have exponential acceleration. Of course, it depends, quantitatively, acceleration rates are different, but flame accelerates exponentially. Exponential acceleration is shown here by this solid, by these markers, these circles. But if you reduce theta at fixed radius, or you increase radius at fixed theta, you will see that linear acceleration is possible. This is a domain when we have linear acceleration. Look at this triangle, this marker, these triangles. So definitely that's the way to slow down the process. We have linear acceleration. But what we talked so far, I should recall, if I didn't mention before, that in all these scenarios we discussed so far, we use classical approach of unity Lewis numbers. And also we use classical approach of adiabatic rules. This should be modified because in reality, Lewis number, well, Lewis number equal to one, it's really classical approach for theoretical studies, but it's not practical. So we should investigate what will be the effect of Lewis number, both in this regime and here. We investigated this. And also what will be effect of heat losses if you go to heat loss. So we still start with adiabatic walls. Why adiabatic again? Real wall conditions are neither as adiabatic nor as a thermal. And we can see the both limits of existing on removed heat losses to see what is practical reality, what are our limitations. So far we keep adiabatic walls and see what happens if Lewis number is equal to one and how flame propagates. Here it is. Here what you can realize. So basically what you can see is that the narrow channels flame accelerates, how it should be accelerated exponentially. And in wider channels, you may have combustion instability, that is the real Landau instability, which generates this non-uniform flame tip. That it is. But if you take Lewis number equal to two, in fact, what will happen? Then your mass and thermal diffusion are not balanced, so flame gets thicker. You artificially increase transfer properties. So you will actually slow down the acceleration. This is still exponential acceleration, but it will go slower. You may realize it will go slower. And key point here, the definite why it goes slow, because when flame is thicker, it's harder to suppress it. I tell you many times, compare blanket and pillow. You can easily pack blanket, but you cannot do the same with pillow. So we have a theory how it goes, and you may see that for Lewis equal to one, here is how sigma depends on Reynolds number. Theoretical curve is shown by brown, by solid black line, while different markers show different simulations. You may see they fit well. But what happens if you increase the Lewis number? Then actually, a small Reynolds, we will have deviation from this curve. So it means that here, there is so-called Marsden effect. It will be effect of flame, it will be stretch effect. It will be flame response to curvature and stretch. Because when flame thickness is finite, you will slow down the acceleration. And this formula may show you how sigma may eventually depend on Marsden and other numbers. So if Lewis number is one, what we'll see. What is here? Here is how radius is equal to 10. Here is radius is equal to 20. And here on the right hand side, when Lewis number is larger than one. Here seed is equal to 5, so we talk about slow acceleration, we talk about linear acceleration, but qualitatively picture is the same. Larger Lewis number suppresses combustion instability and extends flame thickness. That's what you see here, don't you? Here I may show you the characteristic movie, how it goes. So that it is. The more important, so what I can conclude, that if Lewis number is larger than 1, you will have certain modification of flame acceleration, not drastically different, but it will be some slowdown of acceleration. But the picture is conceptually different if you have small Lewis number. Here you can see Lewis number like 0.2, I believe, in different kind of Reynolds number. And what you see here, what we call flame channeling. Because here there are different wings, you may see how flame propagate and what's going on. So in fact, why we call it channeling? Because you may see here that combustion instability generates two arms, like two wings. When they will go separately. At some point, they will match together. That's something special. So you may see here how it goes, how these wings go. I don't know. I think I should show it on this small screen. Yeah. So let me see. I try to do something with the things. Okay. It goes now. Okay, sorry, let's see how this movie shows, how these wings go and how they will eventually meet. That's how it goes. Another point, what we see here. Close here, we'll see how third arm is moved. It's for another Reynolds number. And third arm, like third, is formed here. And eventually, you may see how on long run, this feature disappears. So basically, this effect will eventually disappear, but you will see that the effect is nevertheless strong, so you may feel it. You may appreciate it here. So let me go on back screen as well. Here it is. Okay, so basically on this screen, you can also see so what we actually have. We have first stage, which is so-called bifurcation, when these two wings appear. On third stage, we'll see that center is retarded back and arms are elongated, and eventually they catch up. And third stage, we'll see that third arm is formed on this momentum, and then the flame front assumes globally convex shape again. That's what we see. So a closer look, that's what we have. Now, you may see how it closer look like and how it goes. And eventually again, this effect will disappear, But its initial station can provide really strong acceleration. So if you want to provide extra acceleration to flame, small Lewis number, diffusional thermal instability, which is behind it, it's really something really. For theta is equal to 5, smaller theta, when acceleration is not exponential, you will see now that, again, effect will be slower, but qualitatively exactly the same. Here it goes. You have these long wings, which shows. Now, so that is effect of Lewis number. Now, let's say, what will happen if you have something else? What happened if you have other wall conditions? I tell you that real walls and neither adiabatic nor is a thermal, but we consider both these conditions to see the truth in between them. So, up to now, what we studied were adiabatic walls, there's no heat losses. Now we start employing isothermal walls. And here we employ isothermal cold walls. So we say that the room temperature is and the wall temperature is what we call room temperature, 300 Kelvin. It will be exactly the same as fuel temperature. So what will be there? And as you may suspect, really in that case, heat losses will slow down flame acceleration because you take energy out of your system, of your combustion system. If dashed line shows exponential acceleration that we appreciated before with adiabatic walls, as a thermal wall, cold walls show you this near linear acceleration eventually. So you have this linear stage. The same PE feature you may see here, and then you may see how it goes. You may see all the stage. Now, you may see how it goes. So basically top of the flame is similar to what you had before, but now in the bottom you have this point because you have cooling by the walls. Okay. Isothermal cold walls, that's what we have. And I want to also, I want to show you the movie. Maybe you will see this movie set how it goes. And eventually at some point, it can even stop, flame extinguish because of cooling. This is for smaller thermal expansion. Now, let me ask you, what do you think? What will happen if I have preheated walls? If my wall temperature is, let's say 800 Kelvin, what do you have? And I will tell you that maybe many of you will suggest, okay, in that case, maybe I will have faster flame propagation because we have hotter walls, so they will take less energy from the system and maybe preheat something. You know what? In fact, that is a little bit wrong statement because you don't need extra energy to your system because you are chemistry, your chemical kinetics will provide energy. Combustion gives us energy. What you actually really need, and you may realize it, what you actually really need is the following. There is heat transfer here. So let's say what happens. Let us think. What happens if you really have different wall conditions? What does it actually mean for you? That you have other wall conditions here, if you have preheated walls. In fact, your walls, let it be 800 Kelvin, 600 Kelvin, even 1000 Kelvin. This temperature is not drastically big. So these walls are hotter, definitely, than the fuel. So it will preheat fuel. But this temperature is nevertheless much, much less than the beyond matter temperature. So what will happen if you look here in this picture? Your fuel will be preheated, but your beyond matter will be cooled because these hot walls are nevertheless cold for them. So in that sense, the ratio between beyond matter temperature and fuel mixture temperature will go down. In the previous case, it was not the case because fuel mixture wasn't touched. Now you preheat fuel, so you decrease flame acceleration. And what is curious, that hot walls will provide you slower acceleration than cold walls. Hot, again, I'm not mistaken, hot walls, hot as a thermal walls, will provide you slower acceleration than cold walls. Here you may can compare three cases, adiabatic walls, isothermal wall at cold temperature and isothermal hot temperature. Here it is. And you may see really that this goes slower than this one, but this keeps going slower. To quantify this, please look at the following pictures. So here we plot flame velocity scaled by planar flame velocity. This is central line flame velocity versus scale time. So that is very illustrative and important picture. So brown, black line here corresponds to adiabatic walls, exponential acceleration. while other conditions correspond to isothermal walls. So blue line shows 300 Kelvin case, that is cold wall that we saw before, while green and red one shows like minor oscillations near steady flame propagation at hot temperature. So if you can see the initial stage of this process, the picture on the bottom actually shows even different scenario. Picture on the bottom shows flame acceleration versus scale time, and here you may see different wall temperature. From 300 Kelvin, when you do have linear acceleration, and until 600, when it's almost steady flame propagation. So it's linear acceleration, and if you take angular coefficient from here, it will be just linear acceleration rate. I can write that my velocity is proportional to AT, T is time, A tau, tau is time, and A is this coefficient. And here on this picture, you may see how flame, what's going on here? Let me see here, okay. How flame goes versus time. Yeah, acceleration rate versus wall temperature. So that is what we should realize. And you may see that A decreases with temperature. For higher temperature, there is almost no acceleration. So what is our conclusion from here? Really? Wall conditions play extremely important role. They really change flame propagation. So if you want to kill your flame propagation, please do something with your walls. Include heat transfer to walls. Use isothermal walls. Here again, you may see how velocity change for different thermal expansion at wall, cold wall conditions, and definitely the larger the theta, the stronger acceleration. It's understandable. For different wall conditions, that's what we have. And also, next picture shows something really important. Next picture shows something extremely important, extremely serious. You may see here the different conditions are. So this is so-called T Reynolds theta diagram. So this picture show wall temperature versus channel size, and channel size is here is scaled by flame thickness, which is, so we talk about not real flame thickness, we talk about not real channel width, we talk about scale width scaled by flame thickness, which is important. You know, want to know how many flames can be packed in it for different thermal expansion. So here for theta is equal to 5, what do we have? We have oscillating velocity, so you may see, and in these cases you will have different regimes that may face. So what does it mean? So what it means that we may potentially have linear acceleration, but only for a limited domain here. Most likely we have flame oscillations or minor oscillations that is near steady flame propagation. If you increase thermal expansion, the domain of linear acceleration will grow, but also possibility of extinction will grow. And what you may see here again, we have oscillation regime and quasi-steady regime, of course. When you increase theta to the value of 9, you may see that most likely you don't have oscillations, only for very hot walls. Most likely you will have steady propagation and acceleration. So this regime, this really shows what happened with wall condition. And so what is kind of your conclusion from here is that please employ wall condition. Please employ it because it's something that is really extremely important. Now, what else you can do if you want to modify your regime of acceleration? One of the conditions, one of the classical measure of fire safety is put venting, because you know, you have enclosure, when you have combustion in this enclosure, people say open window and overpressure generated by flame will be removed. That's classical things. In our case, let's consider what will happen if I will open another end. Because remember, in all situations we considered so far, what configuration we deal with? What did we consider so far? We considered flame propagating from a closed end to the open. But what if I open this end? What will happen? If I open this end, you will realize that the flow will move in both directions, right? Flame generated flow will be pushed to the right and to the end. And here, picture on the next will show you flame oscillations. And you will see how it goes, that we observe. We observe some kind of regular flame oscillations. Instead of acceleration, we observe these oscillations in 2D, two-dimensional channel. We don't have theory which prescribe oscillations, but we do have theory which may explain why we don't have acceleration here, why we have only oscillations. Let's show again. So basically here, the flow is distributed between upstream and downstream, it goes slowly. So artificial thermal expansion decreases, and that's why we have oscillations. But what would happen, let me ask you, if I have cylindrical pipe instead of channel? So let's say I have cylindrical pipe with two ends open. So here in this picture, you have symmetry axis here. Again, you have wall friction here and two ends open. Let's see what happens. In contrast to what you suspect, after one oscillation, you have flame acceleration. Again, after one oscillation, you have acceleration. What is it? How it may happen? So let's go. Can any one of you ask, can answer the question? Let it be extra task for you. So please explain me, why do I have flame oscillations in a two-dimensional channel? But I have flame acceleration here. Why may it happen in cylindrical configuration? Please think about this. Actually, I gave this task before I posted this lecture, so please think, and then I will explain it. Okay, let me explain this. Basically, I recall, I don't have theory which may describe oscillations, but I decided the following. Let me say, when do we have flame acceleration and why do we have acceleration and why don't? And to answer this question, I say myself, let me look for steady flame propagation. May it be possible or not? So what is steady flame propagation? It means that I have a flame front. I don't say it's planar, let it be corrugated. But let's say I will have stationary solution with steady propagation. And then I ask myself, does this solution exist or not? What does it mean that the solution exists? It may happen that you may face this in practice or may not, if the solution is unstable, but you can potentially get it. What would it mean that steady flame propagation is not possible? Actually, it will mean two limits. Either is a flame extinguished, so it does not exist, or it accelerates. Listen to me. So it means that I talk, in your case, that you can see the here flame already exists. Okay, so what would this actually mean for us? It means that flame should either be steady or accelerate. So that's what I did. I will start looking for a steady solution when it's possible. How to look for a steady solution? I consider flame propagation like this. This is flame shape, how it goes, and I look for the steady solution. So I describe that basically how to describe the flame shape. I say that each point is given by flame velocity and flow velocity. Like imagine there is a train which goes and you walk across the train. So what is your velocity at each instant? It will be train velocity plus your velocity with respect to the train, isn't it? So the same story here. Here you have flame shape. So each point of the front will be what? It will be local flow velocity plus velocity of the flame with its local flame velocity, which is proportional to local flame surface area with respect to the flame. I don't want you to come to all details, but when I solve this, and here also coefficient here, it shows a fraction of the flow which goes downstairs and upstream. And when I solve it, I come to the idea that here will be velocity, flame velocity, where C is thermal expansion, and N, it's a factor which can be 3 over 2 if it's 2D channel, and 2 if it's cylindrical configuration. Because remember, why we have different configuration? Because remember, for Poiseuille profile, we have different averaging in 2D and cylindrical geometries. But then I realized, though, you know, if I have formula like this, my flame velocity cannot be less than SL, right? My flame cannot be better than planar, cannot be slower than planar. So I realized that this formula exists only when this value is non-negative and it should be larger than one. So it will mean that it may happen only if theta exceeds some value, and here is this value. So now I can say that my stationary flame propagation is possible only if my theta is less than some critical value. Okay, please recall, I don't say it will happen, but stationary flame propagation is possible if CT is less than critical CT. Otherwise, your flame must accelerate. Okay? If CT exceeds this threshold, it must accelerate. Otherwise, steady propagation is possible. Okay? Now, and if you calculate these values, what will you get? You will get that for 2D channels, your critical threshold CT is 9. Which means that your typical flame with CT is equal to 8 that we simulated before, that CT is from 5 to 8 in reality, will be less than this threshold. So it means that you might face steady propagation for those flames. Those flames don't must accelerate in the channel. Okay. But if you consider cylindrical pipe with n is equal to 2, you will see that critical CT is equal to 4. It means that all flames with CT larger than 4, and these are all realistic flames, must accelerate in a channel. So let me take some kind of CT, let's say it's equal to 8 or it's equal to 7. I fix it. What does it mean? It means that my flame with CT is equal to 7. What should I do? It should accelerate, necessarily it should accelerate in a cylindrical pipe, open cylindrical pipe, but in a channel, in 2D channel, it potentially may have a steady solution. That is what we describe here. In cylindrical pipe, my flame with CT is equal to 8, it must accelerate because there is no steady solution here, okay? While in 2D channel, steady solution is possible. Do I have steady solution? No, I don't have. Because it's unsteady, but I have oscillations around the steady solution. You see, I have oscillations around the steady solution. This is a simple model again, which does not describe turbulence, does not describe instability, but this model allows me to describe the situation. Does it make sense? That's why I may expect steady solution in a channel with two ends open. I talk about two ends open, what ranging, but I don't have steady solution. I don't have steady solution if I have both ends open. If I don't have steady solution if I have a cylindrical pipe. So in a cylindrical pipe, I predict acceleration. Overall, so what we can say here before, at next part of the lecture, I will talk about obstacles, but even without obstacles. So what is our conclusion so far? What we can say? We investigated different scenarios, what may promote and suppress flame acceleration. And you may realize from here that what can I do? I can modify Lewis number. I can modify thermal expansion, what we already realized. And in fact, I better go to the later slides that what we see. I will go to the slide by then, but you can already see it here. So basically, what does it mean here? Definitely, so what we already know, that boundary conditions play extremely big role, especially what you should realize here. So basically, boundary conditions plays a role, right? We consider different boundary conditions and it plays a role. Non-slip, slip walls plays a role. And please realize that boundary condition plays so huge role, and that is really, really when you consider boundary condition, that is really happens when you don't have obstacles. You will realize later that when you have obstacles, it will be not the case anymore. Boundary conditions wouldn't play such a huge role. They would play extremely minor. But here, when we have smooth walls, there is effect of boundary conditions. So you may realize what you can do. So what you can do to promote acceleration? Take Lewis number to be extremely small. Not extremely small, just small. It will really trigger thermal diffusion instability, flame will accelerate. Decrease thermal expansion if you can. Play around boundary conditions. Open one end, open second end. If you have venting, it will help you to slow down acceleration or even kill it. Also, think about boundary conditions. Play cold walls, put isothermal walls, they will definitely slow down the acceleration. That's most important. Okay, let me stop at this point, and next time, at next chapter, I will talk about effect of obstacles, about how you can promote and prevent acceleration if you have obstacles. Again, we will talk about thermal expansion, about Lewis number, about boundary conditions, we will discuss how important are they. Since it's a recording lecture, I don't ask you questions at the moment, but I stop sharing screen now and I will record